We are talking today in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 7, verse 18 through 35. So if you want to go ahead and turn there in your Bibles, if you have your version, open up your phone. And if it's available, you probably already on the screen. It's on the outline of the Bible on the computer. It says this, Luke chapter 7, 18 through 35. John's disciples, as John the Baptist, told him about all these things he was doing. Calling two of them, he sent them to the Lord to ask, are you the one who is king, or should we expect someone else? Right? Where the main change is, remember, this is John the Baptist who is proclaiming Jesus. Look, there's the Lamb of God. He had already identified Jesus, but John was in prison, and they weren't going so well for him, so he's kind of doubting and everything. So he tells his disciples, are you really the one? And then Jesus, when the main came to Jesus, they said, John the Baptist sent us to you to ask, are you the one at the time, or should we expect someone else? At that very time, Jesus cured many who had diseases, sicknesses, and evil spirits, and gave sight to many who were blind. So he replied to the messenger, go back and report to John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does something on account of me. After John's messengers had left, Jesus began to speak to the crowd about John. What did you go out to the wilderness to see? A reed swayed by the wind? If not, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No, those who live in expensive clothes and those who left their own palaces. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom is written. I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare the way before you. I tell you, among those born of women, there is no one greater than John. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than him. Verse 29. All the people, even the tax collectors, when they heard Jesus, were not to God's way was right, because they had been baptized by John. But the Pharisees and the experts in law rejected God's purposes for themselves, because they had not been baptized by John. So we have two groups of people, both all received Jesus' influence, one accepted, one didn't. Remember that. You put on stage, to what they try to compare the people's generation. What are they like? They're like children sitting in the marketplace and pouring out to each other. We played the pipe and you didn't dance. We sang the things and you didn't cry. But John the Baptist told me in the meeting, he didn't bring the wicked one, and he said, you got to get it. But the son of Paul came to him and he said, here's a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. The wisdom is congruent by all our children. What in the world am I supposed to preach together with that? That seems like all over the place, right? Well, not really. Remember, the main thing today is that unbelief is caused as a result of a rebellious heart, not a lack of evidence. Here's point number one that we find out in this scripture. There will never be enough evidence to convince the rebellious heart. It does not matter what you think. If your heart is rebellious towards God, it does not matter if he raises the dead, strikes the blind, it doesn't matter. You're not going to believe it. Not because of the evidence, because of the state of your heart. So, John's disciples had said, are you the one? Are you the son of God? And he just said, look at the evidence. Look at what is happening here. Look at this. He goes, go back and forth and tell him, we've seen it, right? The blind receive sight, the lame walk, they can represent lambs, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor people are brought to the poor. What more do you people need? I think Jesus may be asking that question to some of us in here today. What more do you need? Because if you haven't looked at the evidence so far, I don't think anything will convince you that there's not a lack of evidence to see the heart. And people say, well, if I saw dead people being raised, I saw blind people being sight, if I heard saw dead people healed, I believe in Jesus too. No, you wouldn't. Together with a story several chapters ahead that we're going to get to right now this year, but I'm going to bring it up. Luke chapter 16, 27 through 31, Jesus tells a story about a rich man and a beggar named Lazarus. And Lazarus was dead. The rich man was the one who did a man. And both died. Lazarus went to heaven. The rich man went to hell. And the this man could see into heaven. He could see Lazarus. And he called out to Abraham, and Father Abraham, the one who had many sons, many sons of Abraham, you know, yeah. He called out across the board from hell to heaven, and he said, Father Abraham, send Lazarus to get his finger in his water to come cool my tongue, because I'm in agony in this battle. And Abraham said, there's a big chasm. Can't do it, man. Can't do it. And then the rich man says, well, I have five brothers and sisters. Would you please send Lazarus back to them to tell them not to do what I did, to believe you, to everything, because I don't want them to come here. And Abraham says, they got the Bible. They got most of the prophets. Let them listen to them. And the rich man said, no, they're not going to listen to them, but if Lazarus goes back from the dead, they don't listen. And Abraham says, no, no. They don't listen to the most of the prophets, they would not believe even if someone comes back to the dead. And for a reason not to, not because of the evidence, but because of the state of the heart. See, guys, there's a ton of evidence that Jesus is who he says he is. I don't know if you know that. There's no one on this earth, no one in history who has been as influential as Jesus Christ. No one. He's the most influential human being that ever lived. I would say, you can say that in your day, you know, in church, where everyone agrees with you. No. I was on a plane to Nepal in 2012 to go on my first mission trip over to Asia. And when I want to talk to people on a plane, they ask me what I do, like person sitting next to you. If they ask you, I ask you what I do. If I want to talk to people, I'll tell them I'm an author. Because then they ask, hey, well, what did you write about? And I talk about it. But if I don't want to talk to people, I talk about my creator. That means it's just a lot, okay? Well, so I did not want to. I was tired. I was trying to focus on what I was teaching over there, the church planning cause and everything. So the guy sitting next to me said, well, so what do you do for a living? I said, I'm a creator. Figuring that would set him up. He goes, oh, yeah, that's cool. Where are you from? You know? I said, I'm from Kentucky. And he goes, well, Jesus is pretty big there, I guess. Church is pretty big there. And I said, well, actually, Jesus is really big everywhere. Where are you from? He goes, I'm from San Francisco. And I said, well, Jesus is in San Francisco. He goes, what are you talking about? I said, well, the name San Francisco. I mean, St. Francis is named after one of the greatest followers of Jesus all the time. And when John the Church, he's got San Luis Obispo. You've got Santa Barbara, you've got the Martyr, you've got San Jose, you've got San Bernardino, and you've heard about the little town called San Diego, literally all the big cities in California, they got the followers of Jesus. You look at me and go, Sacramento. And I say, great, this is awesome, because the word Sacramento comes from the word sacrament, which is a means of growth and baptism, because you use the word sacrament. Everything in your city is really pointing you to Jesus. I bet he wishes he would turn his head. People say we're a post-Christian society, but Jesus doesn't have any influence anymore. Well, the first 1900 years, from 0 to the year 1900, 1,900 years, it took 1900 years for Christianity to go from 0 followers to 600 million. Is that with me? 0 to 600 million, it took 1900 years, 1,900 years to go to 600 million. Since 1900, and to 2020, which is the last year in statistics, that number has gone from 600 million to 2.3 billion. It's quadrupled in the last 120 years. God stopped the accelerator on the church. The church has experienced exponential growth in just the last 120 years. Those are just statistics. Those are just evidence. Those are just things that are going on. And Jesus, we are finding, is the most written about, the most sung about, the most painted, the most sculpted figure in history. If you were to put a magnet over every museum, fine art museum in Europe, North and South America, parts of the Middle East, and you extracted every piece of art that depicted Jesus or a biblical scene or something like that, it would take up more than half of the fine art that's ever been made. And if you extracted gift with Jesus, to be about 25%. Every piece of art that had Jesus or a cross or angel or church, biblical scene or Messiah, Jesus is the most written about, the most sung about, the most painted, the most sculpted figure in history. No one like Jesus. I instituted resurrection, we celebrated last week. We weren't even close to being done. We weren't evident. We just touched the greatness of Jesus. I want you to go back in time with me to this Friday, 2,000 years ago. Good Friday, 2,000 years ago. And you are looking at a carpenter hanging on a cross. Dead carpenter who's been crucified by the Roman Empire. And a Roman guard sitting there points up to him and says, that right there demonstrates the greatness of the Roman Empire. And I would say, well, okay, let's look at this. Meet me on this spot in 2,000 years. And let's see who is more influential, the Roman Empire or that dead carpenter in Christ. I will bet you $1 million, our currency, that that carpenter will have more influence than the Roman Empire. No one in their right mind would have done that. No one would have taken that bet. Everyone back there would have taken that bet. Yeah, I bet you $1 million, but if the Roman Empire, with its empire, Caesar and Brutus and Julius and all those, would be far more impactful in history than that big carpenter. That Roman guy would have taken that bet in a minute. 2,000 years later, the influence of Jesus. I don't know how many of you can name the two most famous biographies of Hitler. Anybody? How about someone less evil? There are three biographers of Abraham Lincoln. Anybody know who they are? No? Okay, then how about this? There are four biographers of Jesus Christ. Their names are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John, they sure did come. If your name is Matthew, or your middle name is Matthew, or if you have a close family member, a friend named Matthew, please stand up. I'm not kidding. Please stand up. Okay? Let's do the same thing with Mark. If your name is Mark, or know somebody named Mark, or your middle name is Mark, please stand up. Let's keep standing. Keep standing. Okay, if your name is Luke, or you know I have a close family member named Luke. All right, please stand up. If your name is John, or know somebody who's named John, please. You guys don't know anybody named John. Okay, yeah, right. Look around you, okay? Listen, Jesus' influence is so massive that we name our children Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and we name our dog Caesar and Brutus. Okay? Yeah. All right? You realize that Jesus has so much influence on the world that arts and music, and he took away all the music. Because Jesus is influenced. You have no handle of Messiah. The most moving piece of music part ever written handle of Messiah. And my personal favorite, Beethoven's Ode to Joy, I think is the most perfect song ever written. Beethoven said that the song Ode to Joy was what he said, if I could put into music what my heart is feeling when I think of Jesus, that's what Ode to Joy is. That was the sound that his heart made when he saw Jesus. Incredible. We got no healing sight, no Beethoven's Ode to Joy, no Mariah Carey's Christmas album.
I will say this, if someone came to ask him another question,
and they didn't talk with anyone but just observed, his first question would be, who is this Jesus? Because you can't even write the joke without mentioning Jesus. This is in your 2024 life. Jesus was born. You can't even say your birthday without mentioning Jesus. This is the influence of Jesus. This is the evidence of Jesus that we see every day all around us. A hard-hearted person says, well, I can't believe how foolish it is, or that you believe all that stuff. Really, some of these stories were built so fast. He never ruled an army. He never held public office. He never wrote a book. Who wasn't wealthy, who never traveled more than 100 miles out from his hometown. Jesus is the most unique person in all history, and there's evidence for him everywhere. The guy said, well, he may have been really big back then, but not now, not recently. And I shared with him the exponential rise in the church. The fastest growing church in the world right now is in South Korea. The second fastest is in Iran. The third is in Afghanistan. Apparently, Jesus doesn't need political favor to grow his church. Right? He's bigger than that. Christians are literally floating in the world right now. Don't you really think he's the believe anything you see. I got a phone call from an old minister friend of mine who's going to talk with a guy about Jesus. And I asked him what I would say. I said, take him to the resurrection. He goes, why would I take him to the resurrection? I said, well, because the most provable event in history. He goes, what do you mean? I said, well, it was a biblical fact that the tomb was empty, right? If you notice, the people in the Bible, they didn't say, no, there's a body in the tomb. No, that's never been an argument, because there wasn't a body in the tomb. Jesus preached publicly. He healed people publicly. He was tried publicly. He was condemned publicly. He was executed publicly. He was placed in his tomb where everyone knew where it was. There's no secrets to it. Okay? So on Easter Sunday morning, that tomb was empty. Because all they had to do, the early Christian preaching, was all about the empty tomb, how Jesus conquered death. If there had been a body in there, the Jews of course, the Roman of course, would have just taken everybody and said, look, there he is. The Christianity would have gone out, but the thousands of other religions that existed at that time, they couldn't, because the tomb was empty. And then my minister said, so, well, okay, what do I do then? I said, well, tell your friend to explain why the tomb was empty. Tell him. You already know why the tomb is empty. Ask him. Because after two major theories about why the tomb was empty. The first was that the disciples double stole the body. Just stole the body. Just many tax collectors jumped up on a Roman guard unit. Beat them all, I guess. Took them out. See, you got the Roman guard unit, the one that guarded the tomb on Easter Sunday morning, which we have evidence of, was anywhere from 4 to 16 soldiers. And the soldiers who were taken away from their homes at age 12. That's when the Roman soldiers were joined the army at age 12. And from age 12 to 18, we took one thing. They were to defend a 6-square-foot, 2 feet by 3 feet, area of ground in the face of an advancing enemy. Soldiers were killed if the people they were guarding escaped. So if you were guarding someone and they escaped, you were killed. There's a lot of incentive not letting a person escape. Okay? You stick, this Roman guard unit in front of a rock and say, don't let anybody in. And the fishermen and the tax collectors, well, they're some pretty tough guys, I guess, because they snuck up on a Roman guard unit, knocked them out of the top of the rock, went over, stole the body, and did all that living in the tomb. Is that what you're telling me? You guys, you lie to get something you want, not to get beat. You lie out stuff to get out of trouble, not to get into trouble. And so when the disciples were brought in and they were beaten and they were crucified and everything like this, how long would it take you if you were going like that, having to go through that and say, hey, I'm not dying for a while. We stole the body. Okay, this has gone too far. It's a good hope, but we're not doing this anymore. And not one of them did. Every one of them listened and gave us the claim of Jesus. I wonder what they have to do before you start upset. I'm not going for a while. I get that happen. Peter was crucified upside down. Andrew was crucified with skin to life, so vultures ate his flesh while he was still alive. John was born in war. Philip was torn to pieces by an angry man. And the last words on their lips was, Jesus is resurrected. Now, folks, it's not stupid to accept an invitation to celebrate someone of that magnitude. The second theory is basically called the last Tuesday. And the morning on Easter Sunday morning, and when they went to the tomb, they took to the wrong tomb, forgot the location. And I saw them buried on Friday, but on Saturday, forgot where it was and went back to it. And it was an empty tomb, and they went and complained, and oh, the tomb's empty, and everything like that. Well, remember, the location of the tomb is making them feel better. And so all they had to do was take people to the right tomb, because they did not want the message of Jesus. Resurrected to get out. So, I'm not trying to mock folks that they're actually trying to explain away Jesus as something other than some God. I'm not trying to mock folks like that. I'm saying that evidence is there for the hardest way to accept it. It's overwhelming. If you're not following Jesus today, after hearing all of that, it's not a problem of the evidence. It's a problem of your heart. And what about your heart before God? So, my question is this: what did you say to your heart before God this morning? John 33, 34. John the Baptist came even drinking, eating bread or drinking wine. You say he's got a demon. Son of God, some man came eating, drinking, and he's saying, here's a glutton and a drunkard. So, in other words, nothing will make you people happy. Okay? Well, Romans 8, 5 through 8 explains why this is. Why there are people in this room who have seen the evidence of subject Christ and people who have the exact same message that they have rejected. Romans 8, 5 through 8 says, those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, but those who live according to the spirit have their mind set on what the spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death. The mind governed by the spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's will, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of flesh cannot please God. You guys, we're either in the realm of flesh or governed by the spirit. That's it. We're either being governed by the flesh or being governed by the spirit. There's no in between. It's either or. 100%, either or. And if you are, and if you have not, if you have a rebellious heart before God, you'll be still being governed by the flesh. Okay? Pastors definitely have a responsibility for preaching the gospel and preaching the truth and loving the congregation like that. I'm not taking that responsibility. No doubt, I will be judged much closer than any of you for how I have lived my life. There's also responsibility on the part of the people you hear. That's all that you are. To hear the truth, people, Peter and Judas have heard the same messages and saw the same miracles, the same pastor. They both saw Lazarus raised from the dead. They both saw Jesus walk on water. They saw his power. Peter became the rock that Jesus could build his church. Jesus betrayed him. Sometimes it's not the pastor or the preacher. Sometimes it's the heart. Why? Because they have a heart. Well, famous atheist in the world, Richard Dawkins, made waves this week. I don't know if you saw the video of him. He has been the world's leading atheist. He hates Christians. He hates Christianity. He thinks we're a bunch of idiots. He wrote a book called The God Delusion. And he has done everything he can to destroy this stuff the last 20 years. He's a professor of evolutionary biology in England. And he was interviewed this week. It's very interesting what he says. It's a secret whole country of India. Basically, being taken over by the Muslim faith.
Well, I must say, I was slightly horrified to hear that Reverend Dallas being promoted instead. I do think that we are culturally a Christian country. I come from Christian, and it's not a believer. There's like a distinction between being a believing Christian and being a cultural Christian. So, I love hearing these Christmas carols, and I kind of feel at home with the Christian ethos. I feel that we are a Christian country in that sense. It's true that statistically the number of people who actually believe in Christianity is going down, and I'm happy with that. But I would not be happy if, for example, we lost a lot of people in our beautiful territory. So I don't want to have a contrary, but I think it would matter if we certainly could not see any alternative, because that would be completely dreadful.
Well, it brings me to my fundamental point, which is that, as we know, church attendance is plummeting, but the building, the erection of mosques across the world, I think 6,000 are under construction, and there are many more that are being planned. So do you think you would not have to do that? Does it not matter?
Yes, I do, really. If I had to kill a thing in Christianity in Islam, I'd choose Christianity every single time. And it seems to me to be a fundamentally decent religion, in a way that I think is kind of not. And I found that I like to live in a culturally Christian country, although I do not believe a single word of the Christian faith.
What we see here is a fool. And I'm not mocking him. I'm saying that what we see here is a person who claims to be a scientist. And yet cannot see the connection of the inconsistency in what he says. When he says, I like a Christian culture, but I don't like Christ. I like the effects of Christianity, but I don't like Christ. I don't like the cause of all that. That's why Satan likes his first and quote. He doesn't believe in
I like the effects of it, but I don't believe in the cause. This is why I claim we're the evidence, hard evidence of Satan. Romans said he likes the evidence of Christianity. He doesn't believe in Christianity. He likes the effects of God. He does not believe in God. This is other things like that are going on in that line of thought. He likes faith, but doesn't believe in God. He likes movies, but doesn't believe in movie directors. He likes music, but doesn't believe in tradition. This is the logical consistency with his thought. Without musicians, there is no music. Without Christ, there is no Christianity. You cannot have the effect without the cause. Right? He loves Christianity but does not believe in Christ. This is the best example of a rebellious heart before God that I've ever seen. This happened this week. One, after seeing all the evidence, he even said he loves the Christians, he loves the world, he loves the decency of the Christian religion, he loves what it does for society, that he would choose Christianity over any other faith, any other church, after seeing all of the evidence, he still says no to Christ. The very point of last year, the evidence does he not believe, this is why, because he doesn't want to. And the reason you don't want to, and you don't believe, is because you don't want to. Plain and simple. So, the rebellious heart, there's not one thing that I can say to you that will change you. Not one thing, and one thought, nothing. Only God can change someone. And so the power of the Spirit of God has to do what we cannot do, which is change us. God will have to do it us, but we are incapable of doing it ourselves. I am incapable of giving my life to Christ. I'm incapable of it. We approach God and say, I surrender. I'm going to surrender. I can't change myself. I can't change my actions. I can't change my thoughts. I'm going to surrender to you. I'm going to ask you to do that. Because I didn't want to. And the only way to get this level is to change me something. And the only one who can take this man is to up everything in my life that's taking so much faith needs to come to do well. I'm going to need you to do it, God, because I can't do it. Doesn't matter what evidence you show me, I'll find a reason not to believe in it. I wonder how many Richard Dawkins cultural Christians we actually have in here. Love these types of Christians, but I'm not so much about Christ. The truth. And it seems like in Luke chapter 7, 19-30, that the doctor that was in the sense of telling you, I actually believe in the fact that this is the word of God, but because they have been baptized, and done it. The Pharisees and experts of law rejected God's purpose for themselves because they had not been baptized. It seems like the process of baptism does something to accelerate that bad taking over process. If you've never been baptized before, then this is part of the problem. If you've never been baptized, this is something that you need to do, is what the scriptures tell us. I did not go to Christian college. I went to a secular college. I didn't use it. It was pretty adamant about just how Christianity was so old and all these stupid people that fucking Christ were, you know, hidden things with the mental everybody's canceled. That means everybody has canceled, right? I go, again. I don't know why were they here. Well, they had twins from Adam. So every living thing on this planet has an ancestor. Everything looking around, there's not one of you, unless you are the anomaly that I'm putting in the universe. You're not twins. If you go out there, every cat, every thing, every dog, every cat, every tree, every acorn, every thing you're living has an ancestor. And then you're going to tell me that somebody way back when this just happened. And it's a huge process of parent, no kidding. You telling me that? I said, that's unscientific. Don't tell me you believe it. And I said, life gathered those thoughts. And life is not created. Life is imparted from one living being to another. That's what the Psalms tell you. It's not foolish to all of us who believe that God is the first, and it was the first to complete the first law of life. Is there evidence for Jesus? No, that's not the question. The question is your heart ready to see the evidence for Jesus? Because if it's not, the matter of Jesus is still the matter of Jesus. So, here's the question. What is the sin of your heart before Jesus? If you have never done anything that might ask God to do, then cross that boundary, then ask Him to change your rebellious heart to the one that is surrendered so you can see the truth. He's all the beautiful things about Christianity at the right people. That's where you are if you have a rebellious heart this morning. So I'm going to pray for you. I pray for us. I'm going to pray for you today. God will open his heart. God, imagine what he could do if God closed his heart, his eyes. Imagine if he was to believe his thoughts. He's right there. And if you are ready to see the evidence today, if you are ready, just ready to stop being a doctor's Christian, I want to talk to you. Because the evidence is there for the surrender of heart. You come for it. And you come for it. I want to pray for the people here today. Lord, thank you so much for everyone that's been here, that are here, and that's joined us online. Father, I pray that you can give us what we can't do ourselves. We tried, Lord, we tried, but we said, what? We were good for about a week and we fought off. So, Lord, I pray for you to be filled with the Holy Spirit in all of us today. And there are people in here who have never surrendered to you, who never accepted you as Lord, who have never come to you and said, Lord, I pray that they would do that right now. And I pray that Lord, I pray that you would encourage them and turn them and turn them from man to man to man today. The evidence is there, Lord, I just pray that you would open our eyes. We love you. We thank you for the beautiful day. We thank you for this worship time. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Guys, have a great week. See you next Sunday.